Good morning, friends. Today we are going to discuss about the Hall effect experiment. Before going to approach Hall effect experiment, let us recall what we discussed in the last class. In the last class, we discussed about the making of n-type material or p-type material. In the case of n-type material, the majority carriers are electrons. Whereas in the case of p-type material, the majority carriers are holes. Students, just look at this semiconducting wafer. So this is the silicon semiconducting wafer. But whether it is n-type or p-type, how many number of charge carriers are there? If there is a number of charge carriers, what about its mobility? Suppose you want to know all these parameters, and that is n-type or p-type, the number of charge carriers and their mobility, we have to approach the Hall effect experiment. So by using the Hall effect experiment, we can calculate the number of charge carriers and their mobility. And the most important thing is, we can say that it is an n-type or p-type. So let us look at the Hall effect experiment. In the case of Hall effect experiment, we are considering a semiconducting sample. So this is the semiconducting slice. We are taken in a cube, a rectangular cube, and the rectangular piece of the sample. This is the thickness of the sample, and this is the length of the sample, and this is the width of the sample. After considering the semiconducting sample, please connect it to the battery. So one side of the battery is connected here, the positive terminal. Other side is connected to the negative. So after connecting, there is a flow of current. There is a flow of current from positive side to the negative side, and there is a flow of electrons from right side to the left side. We know that electrons always flow opposite to the direction of current. So here the electrons are moving from this side to this side. This velocity is said to be the drift velocity. The drift velocity can be defined as the velocity acquired by the electrons in the presence of an electric field. So the next slide here, I am applying the magnetic field along the positive y direction. This is the y direction. There is a flow of current in the positive x direction. So see what happens now. So due to the magnetic field, there is a charge carriers experiencing a force. That force is nothing but Lorentz force. That Lorentz force, the force acting in the downward direction for the electron. So this is the direction of the force of the electron. This is the direction of the force on the electron. So look at this. So this process continues up to a certain time. That time here, that is the equilibrium position, the one side force is balanced by the other side force. Here, this is the magnetic force is balanced by the upward force, nothing but QE. So look at this. So QB cross B balanced with the upward force QE. Here, the velocity and the magnetic field both are perpendicular, so that BV sin theta into n cap, theta becomes 90 degrees, so BV into n cap, this is the direction of the force, that is the n cap direction. So QVB is equal to QE. Here it is in the case of n type material, more number of electrons here in the downside. If it is a p type material, the more number of holes are acquired on the top of the semiconducting sample. This side, the more number of holes, that is a p type. If it is n type, there is a more number of electrons. So this is a low potential because it is a n type material. So there is a low potential. This is the high potential. So look at this. Because of this potential difference, there is a potential difference between this side and this side. So what next? I'll connect a potentiometer here. So there is a negative potential, this is the less positive potential. So this voltmeter shows negative voltage. That indicates it is a n-type material. This potential is said to be the Hall voltage. And if it is a p-type, this VH value should be positive. So by using this phenomena, we can say that it is a p-type material or n-type material. So if you define the Hall effect phenomena in one particular definition, so when a current carrying semiconductor placed in a transverse magnetic field, then there is a potential difference is developed between the direction of the current and the magnetic field. That potential is said to be the Hall potential. If that Hall potential shows a positive signal, that indicates field time. And if it indicates negative signal, negative voltage, that is said to be the end time material. Now let us look at the mathematical analysis. So here the Q is the upward force balanced with the downward force. Q is equal to QV cross B. So there is a velocity and the magnetic field both are perpendicular. So theta becomes 90. So sine theta component becomes 1. So QVH is equal to QVdB. VD is said to be the drift velocity and EH is said to be the Hall electric field. B is the magnetic field. So QQ get cancelled. EH is equal to VD into B. From the definition of current density, so you can current difference density can be defined as the current flowing per unit area, that is equal to NQ VD. So N is the number of charge carriers. In the place of VD, substitute this value. So you are going to get EH is equal to J by NQ into B. If you rewrite this equation, EH Hall electric field by JB, that is equal to 1 by NQ, where RH is equal to EH by JB is said to be the Hall coefficient. So the Hall coefficient value is smaller for metals because in the case of metals, the RH value will be smaller for metals because the number of charge carriers in the case of metals are more. So RH value is less. Whereas in the case of semiconductors, the N value is little bit less, so that RH value will be maximum. So the next equation I will write EH is equal to JB by NQ by taking this equation. I will write EH is equal to the potential per unit length. So here the Hall electric field can be defined as this is a potential per this particular length. So EH is equal to, I will write VH by this particular direction, VH by D. So VH by D is equal to JB by NQ. J can be defined as current density, I'll write I by A. So VH by D is equal to IB by NQ into A. So this A, area of the sample, can be written. This is the thickness and this is the width of the sample. So D into B, I'll write in the place of A, I'll write D times of T. So DD get cancelled, I'll get VH is equal to IB by NQT. So this is the corresponding expression for Hall voltage. In the case of Hall effect, if I know thickness, I know the magnetic field, the amount of the current and number of charge carriers, so I'll get the Hall voltage. Suppose I want to calculate the thickness of the sample, semiconducting sample. Here I know the Hall voltage from the potentiometer, I know the amount of the current passing through the sample, and I also know the amount of the magnetic field and the number of charge carriers, so that I can calculate the T. Suppose I want to calculate the number of charge carriers or carrier concentration or number of charge carriers. So here I know the VH, I know the thickness, I know the B, I know the I, so that I can calculate the N. Suppose I want to calculate the magnetic field. So provided I know the VH and QT, so that I can calculate the remaining parameter is a D. So apart from this, I can calculate the mobility of the semiconducting sample by using the relation mu is equal to sigma times of RH, where RH is equal to 1 by NQ. So I will write mu is equal to sigma by NQ. So the mobility depends upon inversely proportional to the number of charge carriers. So let us take one of the example problem. Here the amount of current passing through the sample is 50 amperes. And they given the dimensions of the sample. This is a copper of 0.5 cm thickness, as a 2 cm wide, and is placed in the transverse magnetic field. Our field is 1.5 Tesla, and they given the number of carrier concentration. So what we have to determine? We have to define the Hall voltage across the width of the slab. So do this problem. Then after doing this problem, I am getting the answer is 1. Point by using this expression, I am getting the value is 1.105 microvolts. So the solution for this problem is, look at this. So I know the N, this is the sample, this is the Hall potential, and this is the current is passing. I know the thickness. By using all the parameters, the current, magnetic field and the thickness, I am getting corresponding voltages 1.105 into 10 to the power of minus 6, nothing but 1.1 microvolts. So let us take one of the example of Hall effect sensor. Here this Hall effect sensor can be used for rotation RPM of the wheel. So let us go for the explanation for this particular video. So by looking at this particular video, the number of output square waves, if you calculate, that will give the RPM of the wheel. So by using the Hall effect experiment, so we can recall what we learned so far. We can calculate the number of charge carriers as well as the mobility of the charge carriers as well as the conductivity. One more important thing is we can determine the type of semiconductor, is n-type or p-type. Thank you.